Hi, welcome to today's webinar. It's offered to you by our professional learning program. I'm very happy to welcome all our alumni here at this webinar. My name is Frederik Knoet and I'm director of the Tilburg University Fund and I'm also director of alumni relations. And today, as director of the fund, I wanted to ask your attention for something that really concerns me, and it's about our international students. They are in financial distress due to COVID-19. We have all kinds of arrangements in the Netherlands for students, but international students are not covered by this. At the Tilburg University Fund, we set aside funds to help these students who are in financial distress and can't study. I would like to ask you today if you would please consider donating to these students. That would really help them a lot, because you know, if you're in financial distress, it's really hard to study and focus on success. So if you could help us today, we would really appreciate that. We'll send you a tikkie, an SMS, with a request for a donation. And obviously, if you don't want to donate, it's fine, just ignore it. But if you can, and if you are willing to, that would be very much helpful to our students. Thank you, enjoy today's seminar, and see you soon.
Hello and welcome, now in live, after the commercial break, as they say. Welcome to the Tilburg University Knowledge Session of today. My name is Frederik Knoet and I'll be your moderator for today. This session is called Trust in the Blockchain World. And I'm very happy to introduce Professor Eddy Vaassen to you. For those of you who don't know him yet, he's Professor of Accountancy and he has a specialization in Accountancy Information Systems. He is also Director of the Postmaster Accountancy Program here at Tilburg University. And he teaches at Artigas Business School for Business and Society. And he has an excellent track record in what we call professional learning or post-executive education. So we're very happy to have him here. I won't take any more time and I'll give the floor to Eddy. Before I do that, I just wanted to put the house rules for you. What we do is that we all mute our systems, so no sound. We will put on our webcam because it's nicer to look at faces than to look at these black holes, so to say. So please put on your camera. Please do mute your mobile phone and don't use it because we find it interferes with the connection. And obviously, you're okay to ask lots of questions in the chat. Eddy has promised to look at the chat while he's talking and try to answer the questions on the go, and if they are not answered, we'll have a look at them at the end of the session. So thank you all for putting on your camera. I see a lot more faces. Nice to see you. And now we'll go over to Eddy. Now, Eddy, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Frederik. Just checking, you see my full screen now, Trust in the Blockchain World, everybody? Okay, good. I'm talking English now but I was instructed that I could also do it in Dutch. So I would like to hear now from the participants, is there anybody who doesn't speak Dutch? Then please raise your hand, make yourself known, and then I will do this in English. Otherwise, we'll continue in Dutch. Dutch, please. English, please. Well, we have one English, so. English, yes, okay, we continue in English. Okay, so my slides are in English, so that's good. Well, trust in the blockchain world, trust and blockchain, these terms very often are combined. You see them in one sentence, and I did the same. So what do I mean by trust, and what do I mean by a blockchain world? Well, trust is that you believe in something before you know for certain that this is true or that something will happen. So you believe something that of which you don't know that it's really going to happen or that it's a truth. That's trust. Then you need trust. Well, blockchain world, blockchain is a hype term. You may have heard the term in connection to Bitcoin. More about that later, and but there are many more applications of blockchain, and I would like to talk a little bit more about the blockchain applications and then link that to trust today. Okay, let's take an example. like this one. Will a seller indeed ship the ordered goods that they have ordered, that they have ordered and that they made a payment for? This is a common situation when you are working on the internet. For example, you buy something at an electronic market, and then you need one of the parties is going to deliver something, a physical good, and another party is going to make a payment. So who's going to pay first? Or who's going to deliver first? Who's going to do that? And the easiest solution, of course, is to make the transaction where both parties simultaneously transfer the good and the money. But that's in practice, that's very often not possible, because this is only possible when you meet in person. I go to a store, goes for a product that I immediately receive from the shop owner. But on internet, that's not possible. So what can we do to be certain that the seller indeed ships the ordered goods after I have made the payment? Suppose I made the payment, but you can also reverse it, that the seller first ships the goods, and then afterwards he hopes that I'm going to pay for them. It's exactly the same situation. We need to trust each other. And of course, what's the standard solution when you don't trust each other? And that's unfortunately, that's often the case on the internet, that you don't know with whom you are doing business, and there's a lot of fraud on the internet. Then we use a trusted third party for that. I would like to give you an example of Marktplaats, the Dutch place where you can offer goods. Private people can sell their goods and other people can buy them. And what they did is they introduced a system where they themselves, where Marktplaats, together with a payment service provider, function as a trusted third party. So we have the system here, the trusted third party is the first party, the seller, and the second party is the buyer, and the trusted third party is the party that, in this case, receives the money from the buyer, and also notifies the seller that the money is received, so that the seller can, without any risk, transfer the goods, ship the goods to the buyer. So the procedure is that the seller sends a payment request to the buyer. Marktplaats knows of it. Then the buyer pays to Marktplaats through that online pay service, Marktplaats affiliated payment service provider, OBP, could also be Adyen or Ingenico or Bookaroo, all these current companies, or the German Wirecard, which is now negatively in the news. And that service provider, that payment service provider, puts the money on a clearing account until the buyer has received the goods. Both the seller and the buyer receive a payment confirmation from OBP, from the service provider, the payment service provider, that the payment has been effected. Then as soon as the seller receives that notification, the confirmation of the payment by the buyer, then the seller ships the goods to the buyer. Then the buyer sends the goods receipt confirmation to Marktplaats, and then Marktplaats, through his payment service provider, transfers the money to the seller. So you see here that Marktplaats, together with a payment service provider, fulfills a crucial role in this. They are the trusted third party, and because there's a trusted third party, these two parties can do business with each other without the risk that one of the two parties will default. Either no payment or either no shipment of the goods. I'm looking once in a while in the chat, so if there are no questions. So if you have questions, please let me know. Okay, so just in the chat, and then I will look and then answer it immediately. Now, what we can do now is, instead of a trusted third party, which is an organization which we have to pay, which may be economically not feasible or technically not feasible or just too time consuming, we may create a situation where technology, information communication technology, takes over that role of a trusted third party. So what we will do is we will replace a trusted third party, like in this case Marktplaats together with a payment service provider, we will replace a trusted third party by a trust protocol. And a trust protocol, that's merely a piece of software. And that's what blockchain does. Blockchain uses a trust protocol as a substitute for trusted third parties. So what is blockchain? It's quite a complicated mechanism, and it's very difficult to explain this in just half an hour, which I have now, but I'm going to give it a try, and I will skip some elements to make it, to just to avoid that I make it unnecessarily complicated. A blockchain is a distributed database. That means that it's a database that has multiple copies of the same database. So we are with 30 people today in this session. Each of you has a computer that has a hard disk on it, and each of you has a full database of the blockchain. Of the blockchain that we are working in. There's not just one blockchain, there are more blockchains. For example, for the Bitcoin, there's a blockchain, but there's also a blockchain for Ethereum. There's another cryptocurrency. And you can have many, many more blockchains for each individual application. You can have a separate blockchain that you create. Such a blockchain has its own protocol, its own software that runs on the blockchain. So what we see in a blockchain, that the database that's in the blockchain is stored on many computers, on multiple computers, not on just one, but on more than one. For example, if we together, the 30 people that participate in the session, will decide to build a blockchain for the 30 of us, then we will have 30 completely identical copies of the database. And the database will, for example, contain transactions. So in that database then, we see that there are clusters of transactions that are blocks, they are called blocks, that are sequentially interlinked. So sequentially means in time, they are linked. So a more recent transaction comes later in the blockchain than an older transaction, which comes later than an even older transaction. So that every transaction that you see now is more recent than a transaction that's earlier in the blockchain. And these blocks, they are linked to each other by so-called hashes. And I will explain later on what hashes are. Now, in these sequentially interlinked clusters of transactions to the blocks, there are also tokens that act in a certain way. Namely, they follow the rules of a specific trust protocol. And as I said, that trust protocol is a piece of software. And for example, a very famous blockchain is the Bitcoin blockchain, Bitcoin cryptocurrency. At the moment, 8,200 euros, one Bitcoin. That the Bitcoin has its own blockchain and it has a certain software. And we call that software for the Bitcoin Core software, Bitcoin Core software. And the Bitcoin Core software that manages that blockchain for the Bitcoin is an example of a trust protocol. And what that software does is just administer transactions. And in Bitcoin, a transaction is a very simple thing. Namely, I have Bitcoin and I want to send the Bitcoin to one of you. What I do then is I have a wallet, an electronic wallet where my Bitcoins are stored. And from my Bitcoin address, I send that Bitcoin to your Bitcoin address. Everything electronically. What happens then, as soon as I send that to my wallet, so for example, with my phone or with my computer, at the moment that I send this transaction, this payment to you, then this is a transaction that's being picked up by all the computers in the network. And for the Bitcoin, there are around 10,000 computers in the network. And all these computers see my transaction. And then they check if this is a valid transaction. And when is the transaction valid? When I want to pay one Bitcoin to you, well, it's a valid transaction if I really have that that Bitcoin. If I don't have a Bitcoin, suppose I only have half a Bitcoin in my wallet, I cannot make a payment of one Bitcoin. It's the same as what you do with banking transactions. If I have 10 euros on my bank account and I want to pay 20 euros, then they'll say, well, you're not going to do that because you don't have the money. Exactly the same happens with the blockchain of the Bitcoin. If I don't have the money, if I don't have one Bitcoin and I want to pay one Bitcoin, then it's an invalid transaction. But instead of one trusted third party, the bank, we have in the blockchain, we have the Bitcoin blockchain, we have 10,000 validating parties. So not just one, but all computers in the network do this validation check. That means that if I want to have this transaction being recorded, becoming a real transaction, so becoming settled in banking terms, then we need consensus about the validity of my transaction. And in the Bitcoin blockchain, consensus is defined that if 50% plus one of the computers in the network find this valid transaction, then it is a valid transaction. But that means that more than 5,000 computers have to say that this is a valid transaction. So multiple checks, each of these computer checks if I really have that one Bitcoin, if I want to transfer it. So that's a very reliable mechanism because 5,000 checks are better than just one check by a bank. And a Bitcoin, that's an example of a token. The token is a generic term. The formal definition of a token is a chain of electronic signatures. By cryptographic technology, a token is sent from A to B, from my wallet to your wallet. We will use cryptography for that, and the general term is a token. A transaction, as I already indicated, can only be recorded in the blockchain if it has been validated by a majority of the nodes that participate in the network of that blockchain. Important to realize, so 50% plus one for the Bitcoin blockchain is needed to make it a valid transaction. Then these transactions are collected in a block, so a cluster of transactions, transactions that at one point are offered. And for the Bitcoin blockchain, every 10 minutes on an average, a block is written on average. So all these transactions, let's say that these are 3,000 transactions. Such a block with 3,000 transactions can only be recorded in the blockchain if the use consensus mechanism allows this. And then the consensus mechanism, I will talk about that later, but with the Bitcoin blockchain, the consensus mechanism is so-called proof of work. Remember that term, proof of work, that's a consensus mechanism, and proof of work sees to it that a block with transactions is being recorded to the blockchain. Then once a block, so the transactions in the block is recorded in the blockchain, it cannot be removed or altered. A blockchain is a shared single source of truth because of that. Because once it is recorded after validation, you know that what goes in is validated, so it's correct. And then once it's in the blockchain, it cannot be removed or altered. Well, these are two very important characteristics. Can you imagine an information system, a database, where everything that goes in, you are sure that this is true, that it's a fact what goes in, and then once it is recorded, nobody can change it. That means, as I indicated in this last bullet, the blockchain database is a shared single source of truth. It's the only truth. All the ERP systems, all the other information systems that a company has may contain errors, but the blockchain cannot be changed. That's the single shared source of truth. Now, I would like to do a short poll with you. Three questions. There you are. And we will share the results then. There you go. Okay, I have 25 answers. I think that's it. 10 seconds, and then I will go to the to view the results. Okay. So here are the results. You can see them, okay? So 32% have Bitcoins. That's quite a substantial number. So what I did before I bought Bitcoins, I don't have a lot, but before I bought Bitcoins, I really wanted to understand how it works. So I studied how blockchain works so that I would not be surprised by stupid things that I would do with the wallet and the Bitcoin addresses that I have. So to avoid mistakes, because Bitcoin at the moment, as I said, is 8,200 euros. It's quite a big amount of money. An interesting question, do you work with blockchain technology for other purposes than cryptocurrencies? That's a small number. If you have some time left at the end, I would hear from these 12%, so three people, what the applications are that they are working with. So blockchain applications other than cryptocurrencies. And then going back to slide two, would you classify blockchain in the world of facts or the world of beliefs? I indicated that blockchain creates a truth. Everything that is in the blockchain is 100% true, because it's validated before by a large group of computers according to fixed algorithms. Second, once it is in the blockchain, it cannot be changed anymore. And I'm going to explain why that is possible, that it cannot be changed anymore. So that means that indeed classify blockchain the world of facts or the world of beliefs. Blockchain is a concept from the world of facts. So it's about absolute certainty. That's also why sometimes the term trustless is used in a blockchain world. That doesn't mean that people don't trust each other, but it means that trust is a redundant concept. Nobody needs trust in a blockchain world because the trust protocol takes care of trust. So nobody is interested in trust anymore. You don't need to have that belief in something before you know for sure that something will happen. And that's the blockchain world. I see that there are some questions. Okay, I'm going to the few questions now. The first question by Rijn, what if the buyer does not send the goods received? So we are talking to the marktplaats. Yes, marktplaats did it like this. They will anyhow then send the payment to the seller. They do it like that. And they try to find out then where the goods are, because track and trace is an important element of the service that marktplaats delivers. They do track and trace, and then if the goods really were not delivered sent by the sender, then they can sue him, of course. But it's very transparent, the system. In a blockchain world, so if you have a smart contract in place so the trust protocol in place, this would be not a good approach, because smart contracts that you want on the blockchain to make that payment and to after the goods are received, that would do everything automatically. So you need a goods receipt notification, because everything in a blockchain world needs to be programmable. No people involved anymore, so no human judgment anymore possible. Also no lawsuits possible, because upfront you write a smart contract and everybody is forced to comply with the contract. It's impossible to not comply, because a smart contract executes itself based on a trigger. In this case, the goods received notification is the trigger sent to the smart contract. The smart contract transfers the money to the seller. Is that clear, Rijn, that first question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Then Christina, how do the 50% plus one computers validate a transaction, on which criteria? There are many criteria, more than 20, but the most important one is, if I want to transfer one Bitcoin, do I have one Bitcoin in my wallet? So they can check, because the blockchain database is completely transparent. Everybody can see. You also, we at the moment, I could show you the blockchain database and see exactly how much money was sent to a certain Bitcoin address and how much money was paid by a certain Bitcoin address. So every computer can automatically check if a certain Bitcoin address that wants to transfer money to another Bitcoin address indeed has enough Bitcoins to transfer. So if I don't have one Bitcoin, I cannot transfer one Bitcoin. That's the most important validation criteria. They also look at various format aspects, but this the validation of do I have the money is the most important one. Okay, Christina?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. And Rijn has another question. What if the criteria I have the Bitcoin so I could transfer it is met? Yeah, that one, yeah. But someone else is initiating transaction by itself, a valid transaction, but fraud is it did not. Someone else cannot do that, because a token, Bitcoin is an example of a token, and only the person who has the private key of that Bitcoin address, of that wallet and the Bitcoin address, can send a token, can send a Bitcoin to another Bitcoin address. So if you don't have the private key, compare a private key with a very complicated and long password, then it's impossible to send from a certain Bitcoin address. Just impossible. The protocol That's also that's used for the Bitcoin. Doesn't allow that. Rein, is that clear? Is that an answer to your question?
By itself, it's clear, but because it's such a long token and such complex, I cannot remember it in my head, right? So I have stored it somewhere. So exactly. If someone could access that private key with intent to transfer the Bitcoin to himself, right?
Exactly, yes. So what you should do is keep it offline. You cannot type it. It's long. It's 34 characters or even more. So you make a file out of it and you store it offline on a USB stick, but you never have it on the place where hackers in your computer could reach it. This is exactly what happens in the big cryptocurrency exchanges. When you read about fraud with blockchain, with Bitcoin, for example, then this is always that a hacker breaks into an exchange, and that exchange has a service, a very good service. They maintain the wallets of their customers. And they have the private keys of their customers, not you as a customer. You just have a PIN code of 4 digits to enter your phone, and that's it. But your private key is managed by the exchange where you have stored your money. And then if a hacker breaks into that exchange, they can, and they gain access to all the passwords, then they can send money from your wallet, from your Bitcoin addresses, to other Bitcoin addresses. And of course, the other Bitcoin addresses where they send the money to will be their own Bitcoin addresses.
Yeah. So it's basically the same, like if they break into my wallet and grab out the notes and go to the shop and buy things. Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. That's the best. That's a good metaphor. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Is there a role for Jacob? Is there a role for the author with worldwide use of blockchains for multiple purposes? Yes. There is a role. There are many roles for the author. I myself am an auditor, and the first moment where the author comes in place is when there is a blockchain application and there is a smart contract written. Such a smart contract, as I indicated, is a contract that executes itself. The contract is administered on the blockchain, and everybody on the blockchain, every node, the computer in that network, they make use of that same smart contract. And you cannot change that smart contract because it's visible to all the other participants in the blockchain. You cannot just change the smart contract because all the other participants will see that. Now, what's important is that the smart contract doesn't contain errors. It cannot contain mistakes. And there were some smart contracts that were programmed the last 3 years that contained bugs, like any software package contains errors. And they only found out that there were errors in that software, in that smart contract, after it went really wrong. For example, there was this Ethereum distributed autonomous organization that acted as an investment fund. They collected $150 million from to crowdsourcing, and then they wanted to use that money, for example, to finance art projects. But within a few hours, a hacker broke into that smart contract because that hacker discovered a mistake in that contract and stole $50 million dollars. From that smart contract. So it's important that IT auditors do an audit on smart contracts. That's the role of an auditor. What an auditor also can do is become a member in a blockchain, become a node, so a member of that network with this computer, and do continuous monitoring on every transaction that's being done in the blockchain, because the auditor does the validation checks by himself based on what he wants to know as an auditor. So becoming a node in a blockchain application. Also, the very first transaction that's recorded in a blockchain, that's done by people. So in a new blockchain, there is always a, we call it the genesis transaction. That very first transaction needs to be verified, and that's a physical thing. For example, if I want to put a bottle of wine, I want to create a virtual representation as a token of a bottle of wine in a blockchain, then the first recording of that bottle of wine needs to be checked. So there is a wine farm who puts that into the system, and if that wine farm wants to perpetrate fraud with that wine, then everything that follows in that blockchain is also incorrect. So you need to have an auditor there also, the first recording in a blockchain. There are apps that we use, wallet apps, that may be unreliable, so an audit on the apps on our phones. So many roles for auditors. Okay? Jacob, clear? Austrian economics in the Keynesian economy is quite a hassle. Yeah, that's a very complicated question. You're right. In the crypto world, there is no authority. The invisible hand is doing all the work. And in the Keynesian economy, the government believes that they can influence the economy. So indeed, we must believe in the invisible hand of the classical economists of the Austrian school. Yeah, if you don't do, then you will never be a proponent of a blockchain. I agree. Okay, clear. So these were some questions that we had. Let's continue now. What am I doing with my time? Okay. Yeah, let's see. Why use blockchain? Well, you want to use blockchain, for example, to enhance reliability of information. Blockchain is a shared single source of truth. So if I have a database with all the transactions that were ever done, for example, with Bitcoin or with any other token, then we know for sure that these transactions actually happened the way they happened. So 100% reliability. Safeguard assets. I can make from assets, digital or physical assets, I can make a virtual representation in a blockchain. So I can transfer a virtual good, for example, a bottle of wine, my previous example. I can make a token out of that and administer that token in a blockchain. So if the bottle of wine goes from me to you, I also transfer that token from my token address to your token address that represents that bottle of wine. In such a case, you can perfectly well follow all the transactions in the supply chain that cross organizational boundaries. We can also use blockchain for enforcing compliance with applicable laws and regulations because we write smart contracts, and because smart contracts will always be executed if a certain criterion is met, so that the contract executes itself based on a certain trigger, and it cannot be stopped. Then we know that compliance will always happen as long as the smart contract is defined properly. So compliance by default. That's why you can enforce compliance. And then we can make interactions between members of ecosystems more efficient and effective. So we can make supply chains faster. We can manage business processes faster. We can take all kinds of intermediaries out of a system, out of a supply chain, so that the supply chain becomes shorter and the money or the other values go to the people who really deserve the money. And an interesting example here is copyrights of music. There's a songwriter that writes beautiful songs, but there are so many different parties in between before the song reaches the audience to Spotify or a CD or a DVD, that there's only a very small amount of the money that goes to the songwriter. And all these parties in between, all these intermediaries, receive a lot of money for that. In a blockchain world, you can say we take out all these intermediaries and replace them by a trust protocol. And then the trust protocol manages the whole chain. And we have examples of that, of artists who did that already. So you can make an ecosystem or a supply chain, if you will, more efficient. These are all internal control goals. Interesting to know from an auditing perspective, these are all internal control goals that you can realize with the blockchain. When to use blockchain? Well, first of all, there must be a shared database where more parties than one can write data to. It's a shared database that's recorded on many different computers. I have a copy, you have a copy, your neighbor has a copy, everybody has a full copy of that database, and there's more than one party who can write to that database. Those parties are members of different legal or economical entities, so different organizations, or economically speaking, or economically or legally speaking. These parties don't trust each other. Think of the market example that I gave, where I sell something to you and we don't know each other, and still we need to trust each other to do it and to make a transaction. And it is also not possible to have a trusted third party in place, economically or technically not feasible. So what you can do with a blockchain trust protocol, you may replace a trusted third party, as Marktplaats did with their online payment service provider. Now, how does a blockchain work? So as I said, there are multiple copies of the same database. on computers spread all over the world. If you want to participate as a node computer in the Bitcoin blockchain now tonight, you can go to you just Google download Bitcoin software, and then you can download it from GitHub, for example. The software, you run it, and then your computer starts synchronizing with other computers to have a full database of the Bitcoin blockchain. And then after a few days, at least 24 hours from now on, you will have a full copy of the Bitcoin database. All the transactions that ever have been done with the Bitcoin will then be recorded on your computer. And if you leave your computer on, your computer starts working as a validation node, so checking if the transaction indeed is a valid transaction. And then just putting a transaction that you found to another node in the network, also to do the same validation check. So the validation rules, we already had some questions on that. So there is one big validation rule and many derived validation rules. The big one is, if I want to transfer money from A to B, do I have that money? Transactions are grouped into blocks by so-called miners, and miners are very powerful nodes in the network. You with your laptop or your desktop computer cannot, in the Bitcoin blockchain, you cannot become a miner. You need a very powerful so-called application-specific integrated circuit. Big computer with fans on it to cool the processors, because there's a lot of internet traffic, and that these miners, they do a very specific thing. What they do namely is, they collect all the validated transactions that have not been written to the blockchain yet, and then they put it in a block, and then with that block they are going to do some calculations. And the thing that they have to do is, which is very time consuming and takes a lot of computer capacity, is find a number that together with the other numbers in that block that they have created, so the numbers based on the transactions that are in that block, find a number that together with the other numbers in that block lead to a hash that is smaller than a target hash that's provided by the system. Now, this is complicated. The puzzle is, I repeat what I just said, the puzzle is, what these computers need to solve, these miners need to solve, is find a number that together with the other numbers in a certain block that a miner has created lead to a hash that's smaller than a target hash. Now you need to know what a hash is for that reason. Anybody know what a hash is? I don't see any, let's see. No idea, okay, that's very explicit. Yeah. Yeah, okay, passwords, okay, Manoa, yeah, good, yeah. Yeah, okay, well, let me first explain what a hash is. A hash is a so-called mathematical trapdoor. You have a certain input, you put it in a hashing algorithm, and then the output is something, some number, for example, you can have 64 digits, and you cannot calculate back from the output to the input. You can only go from input to output. You cannot calculate back from the output to the input. And this has to do with the fact that a hash uses so-called modulus functions. So for example, 7 divided by 3, what would that be? If you don't know decimals and you don't know how to calculate parts of numbers, 7 divided by 3 will be 2 remains 1. So because 2 times 3 is 6 plus 1 is 7. And the 1, so what remains after you divide, that's the outcome of a modulus function. Yeah, you wonder, also 11 proof is also an interesting one. That's a much more simple thing than a hash. Nowadays, in the IBAN numbers that we have, a hash is calculated from the numbers. And if you Google it tonight after the session, you can find how the IBAN hash and the NL is calculated. But because the numbers after NL in our bank account, two digits, that's a hash using a modulus function. But as I said, a hash can go from input to output, but you cannot calculate back from output to input. What you can do is take the output, and then through trial and error, you can try to find the input, but only by trial and error. And that's exactly what these miners do. these miners, they just start using generating numbers, combine them with the other numbers in that block where all the transactions are in, and then they hope to find a hash that's smaller than the target hash. Now, what we are talking here is about a hash that consists of 64 numbers, hexadecimal, so in a system not decimal but hexadecimal, which means 16 numbers instead of 10 numbers. So it's a very complicated and long number that we are looking for, and the challenge is find a number that together with the other numbers in the block lead to a hash that's smaller than the target hash. You cannot calculate a number, you can just try. So billions of times these miners try numbers combined with the other numbers in the block. And if a miner finds a number that leads to a hash that's smaller than the target hash, then he has a solution. And then the miner acquires the right to write a block that with transactions that he created, to write that to the blockchain. And then that block with transactions is appended to the last block in the blockchain through a hash, because part of the block is the hash of the previous block. This is very complicated. It took me 1 year to understand this. So I don't expect you to understand this, but what happens now is that if you have a block, for example, here we have block 205 on this slide, and at the moment we are already at block 2012 that miners are working on to try to write that. Now, if a cheating node wants to change this block, for example, I'm a cheater and I have this full database on my computer, like all the other nodes in the network have the full database. I want to cheat. I want to change a number, a Bitcoin address. I want to change that into my own Bitcoin address. For example, I see that there's one Bitcoin address where 20 Bitcoins were sent to by another Bitcoin address. Well, what if I change the Bitcoin address into my Bitcoin address where the money went to, so that I will have 20 Bitcoins on my address? I can do that on my computer. But then I should also try to convince all the other computers in the network, who have, of course, the original database, not with my fraudulent input. I have to convince them that this is a valid transaction, what I'm doing. Now, what I then need to do is I need to calculate for my block for 2005, where my transaction is in, I need to recalculate the hash of that block. Problem is, so I change something in the block, the hash will be completely different of this block. But that hash of this block 205 will be also the input of block 2206. Because in 206, there is a number that the miner had looked for to find the hash that's smaller than the target hash with the other information in that block, including the hash of the previous block. So if I change the hash of this block 205, I also need to change the hash of block 206. And the hash of this block is also input for block 207, so I also need to change the hash of 207. I need to change the hash of 208. I need to change the hash of 209 to 10 to 11 up till 212. But on average, because I have to try so often, so much, billions of times I have to try, this takes 10 minutes per block to re-mine, to do the mining again, to find that number that meets the criterion. The number that I reach after hashing is smaller than the target hash. So I need to redo the hashing for all these blocks. On an average, that takes 10 minutes, knowing that all the other miners, they just continue with block 2013, 14, 15, 16 after this. I will never catch up with them. So it's virtually impossible for me to just change something here, because all the other miners, they just continue with the real blockchain. And then the longest blockchain is always, according to the software, is always the blockchain that is the only truth. The shared single source of truth is the longest blockchain. Now think about that. That means that nobody can cheat. Once a block has been written, and there are 2, 3, 4, 5, or even more blocks after this, then this block can never be changed anymore. Is this more or less clear? Yes. Ryan, that's a good question. If you now this block is just as no, let us go to block 211, that has just been written. So Ryan says, I'm the miner writing the last block. You do not need to change anything because you are in this block. And then if anybody, not only you as a miner, but anybody who has access to this block, and that is all the nodes in the network, even you with your computer, you can change a recording in that database. And then, if you want to change the blockchain, you only need to redo the work of this block. And I said it's a random process. On average, it takes 10 minutes, and you may be lucky when you want to change something here, that you can do it in 2 minutes by just finding the number on earlier than the other ones, and all the other ones, they took them more than 10 minutes to reach the solution. And then you can have rewritten the blockchain. So there is always a risk that when not one, two or three blocks have been written after a block, so for example here after block 2 and 11, there's only one block after this, there's always a risk that within one, two or three blocks, somebody can change the blockchain. After three blocks written over an existing block, it's not possible anymore. And you can calculate that mathematically. But this is a shortcoming, there's a risk that in a blockchain. But after three blocks, it cannot be changed anymore. Okay, Rein?
Yes, thank you.
So mining, by mining a block of transactions, it is made sure that the block after it has been written cannot be changed anymore. So mining uses hashing, find a number that gives a hash that is smaller than a specified target hash. Mining takes a lot of computer capacity, so miners want to be rewarded for their work. We call this, what miners do, we call that proof of work. You deliver proof of work when you find a number that together with the other information in a block and the hash of the previous block gives a hash that is smaller than the target hash. Now, use cases. There are various use cases, for example, land registry. Suppose there's no land registry, kadaster in Dutch. There's no kadaster, then you could replace, you could use land registry blockchain to record all land transactions so that you know that there's only one person who owns that land. If there's no central recording of ownership of land, or other real estate, then five people come up with a contract and all may claim that they are the rightful owner of the land or the other real estate. That's because there's no central authority. So there's no trusted third party. So if you replace, if you don't have a trusted third party, you can use a trust protocol, and then the trust protocol functions as the trusted third party. And then you can use for land registry. Tickets, we have companies in the Netherlands, Guts Ticketing, that directly sell tickets from the artist to the visitors of their performances. Guus Meeuwis, for example, participates, Jochem Meijer, Joep van het Hek. You can buy the tickets through a blockchain application. There's no person involved, and directly the money goes directly from the person who buys it. The ticket comes on a smartphone to a blockchain application, cannot be changed, and the money goes directly into the wallet of the performer, I mean artist. Very effective and efficient system. Elections. Can you imagine that your identity is in a blockchain? So not in your passport, but in a blockchain application that runs on your smartphone. Then the election is merely sending a token from A to B, namely from your wallet to the wallet of the voting agency. So you don't need to go to a bureau somewhere. In Corona times, this would be wonderful to do elections. As a very safe system, because you can only vote once. It's not like with an SMS voting where you can send more than one text message for a vote. No, with elections on a blockchain, you can only send one vote, not more. That's embedded in the mechanism of a blockchain. Track and trace in supply chains. I gave the wine, the vineyard example of bottles of wine. Electronic markets. I gave Marketplaats as an example. Electronic rights management, intellectual rights management. I gave the example of the artist that sells directly to his music to the users. Licenses that you cannot obtain. You can also put your personal credentials for job applications in the blockchain. For example, if you graduate from Tilburg University, the university has a blockchain application. They run a server that is a node in a network of nodes that is shared all over the world, where the parties that want to know if you are not lying about your personal credentials, so the master degree that you have from Tilburg and the grades that you acquired, they can just directly check on that database, a blockchain database, to see if you are not lying, because university is part of the blockchain. Then banks use, for example, zero knowledge range proof for privacy. If I want to give a mortgage as a bank, then I need income information. But I don't want to record all that income information because under the GDPR, AVG in Dutch, it's very risky to record all that personal information. So what we do is in the blockchain, we make ranges. We make ranges that indicate whether a person is entitled to a mortgage or not, without recording the exact salary of a person. Compare this with you buy liquor at the liquor store, and the liquor store owner now wants to see your password to see if you are older than 18. Well, he doesn't need to know that you are 19 or that you are 25. He also doesn't need to know your social security number. He doesn't need to know your length, your height, I mean. Not know what your color of eyes is, where you were registered with your password. None of his business. He only needs to know if you are older or younger than 18. That's what we mean by zero knowledge proof. Are you older or younger than 18? The liquor store owner needs to know that. And with a blockchain application, when your identity, for example, is in a blockchain, you can do that. Well, liquid assets can be swapped at banks, large amounts. Rabo recently swapped 25 million in a matter of seconds without any transaction fees in a blockchain application. Energy exchange between people, households who have solar panels on the roofs. One family uses more energy, other family use less energy, and then they exchange energy, and the settlement is done through a blockchain application. No trusted third party needed. Triple entry accounting, a third recording of all transactions that a company does in a blockchain, the shared single source of truth, and when there are deviations between the ERP system of company A with the blockchain, then the mistake is in the ERP system and not in the blockchain, because the blockchain is a shared single source of truth. You see, there are many examples. And an interesting one is this, the distributed autonomous organization. That's an organization that's represented by rules and coded as a computer program, completely transparent, controlled by shareholders in a certain blockchain application, no central government, because it's managed by a blockchain application. That investment fund that I talked earlier about today, that was an example of a DAO, a distributed autonomous or decentralized autonomous organization. That was entirely based on a smart contract that ran on Ethereum, another blockchain than the Bitcoin blockchain. And these are the types of organizations that you can think of when we are talking about the so-called programmable economy, an economy where platforms like Uber, Airbnb, but also all these electronic markets or Facebook or Google, all these companies that bring supply and demand together in an electronic way and want to function automatically. That's where these distributed autonomous organizations will become more and more important in the near future. And all these distributed autonomous organizations all run on blockchain applications. Now, some questions I see. Hans, how could a risk math with certainty match? Hans, can you explain your question? I don't quite understand what your question is.
Yes, we talked about the risk the last two blocks. But in your introduction, you talked about the blockchain is. Is a certain way of truth.
Yeah.
So I see a certain mismatch about this.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Yes. Yeah. What my claim is that with blockchain, because everything that's recorded in a blockchain is 100% true. So if I do a transaction with you, for example, the marketplace, transaction, I sell something to you and expect that you pay me the amount that we agreed upon. You can have such a transaction completely safe without any risk be administered on a blockchain because of the characteristics of a blockchain. So for that specific part of the world, that transaction between you and me, there's 100% certainty that both of us will meet our obligations. So it's not everything is certain. And that's why in the beginning I said a world of certainty. Of course, the entire world will never be certain. It will be about certain elements of that world.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, is that clear?
Yes, clear. Yes.
You will, next session, you will have also a decision making on the uncertainty. So we will continue with uncertainty because the world is uncertain. But the blockchain, you take away a little bit uncertainty for certain transactions.
Okay, but I don't think we have an 100% certainty with this example. Another member someone told us, but.
It's never 100%. I agree with you. Because there may always be some flaws. Somebody may find out about your private key and then do transactions on your behalf. So that's the risk that we need to organize. And that's also why auditors may still remain important, but their task may change. Referring to another question that we had earlier today.
Yes, it needs to be audited, the technology.
Exactly, but this is another type of audit that's going to happen. So the auditor will, this profession will completely change, not only in the financial numbers and the knowing if financial statements comply with international financial reporting standards. That's all profession that can be done automatically. Now the auditor has to go into data and see if the data are of high quality and if they are not manipulated in the world of platforms and where everything goes automatically.
Okay.
Yeah. Given the time, how much more time do you think? Because we're nearing to 8:30, and I was just wondering how you're coming to the takeaway.
This was my last slide. Yeah. So no problem. I'm making it. This 1 minute. So I'm looking at the questions. So Yolanda, you said credentials of 1997. Yolanda, what you asked that earlier today. What was it? In what context? Yolanda, are you there?
Okay. Yeah, it's about the credentials of Tilburg University, where they were.
Yes, okay, yes. Well, Tilburg can, of course, they know who graduated, and we can do that looking back, they know exactly who graduated, what numbers, because the university has an archive, and they can build that blockchain retrospectively. Yes, it would be possible. Actually, I am involved in a project with the Spanish university, to just test if we can do that. So we have a server here, and in Madrid they have a server. Then we can see if we can exchange bilaterally onto a blockchain application the credentials. Just testing.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, then Manon, anyone who can access the database block with your information can see all the information. No, that's the idea. There are two possibilities. Of course, you can have a so-called private blockchain, where a limited group who is allowed to see all the data can see the data in readable form. So see your BSN, see your name, address, etc. But most real blockchains, like the Bitcoin blockchain, is a public blockchain, where there is not one party in charge. Everybody can read the database. But what you can read, for example, for the Bitcoin blockchain, you can only see the Bitcoin address that sends an amount of Bitcoin, the amount of Bitcoin, and the address that receives the amount of Bitcoin. And there's no register or index that links the Bitcoin addresses to people, to the names of people. And that's what I mean with the public blockchain. What you can do is working, for example, with that zero knowledge range proof, where all kinds of information about you is recorded. That information is recorded in a hash form. So you can use it for verification purposes without having to read the actual data. Compared with the password, if I have a password, I register, for example, at bol.com. I register my credentials. I choose a password. That password is hashed by bol.com. The hash of that password is recorded. And next time when I want to log to bol.com, I type in my password, and immediately the same hashing algorithm is used on my password that I just typed, and the hash is compared with the hash that's in the database of bol.com. So they compare hashes and not actual passwords. And bol.com can never find out what my password is because they didn't record it. They only have the hash of my password. And typical for hashes is you can't calculate back to the original number. Manon, clear? No, you say, which means that you need a lot of hash to check whether someone is 18 or old. No, this is not. So when it's recorded that, for example, the birth date of somebody, you don't need to check it. You just need to know to input a certain number to see if this number matches the hash, is bigger or smaller than the hash. So you don't need a lot of, there's no trial and error here. No, that's not needed. Okay, good. I think these were the last questions. This time, the takeaways are this. An important use case of blockchain is cryptocurrencies, but there's much more. Distributed ledger technology is a generic term for blockchain. I kept on using the term blockchain, but if you use DLT, distributed ledger technology, you make it a much more generic term. We live in a world of uncertainty where trust is essential for transacting. A world of certainty where trust is not needed can be created artificially by using distributed ledger technology, so by using blockchain. Through its versatility, distributed ledger technology has great potential in control, finance, process management, supply chain management, audit, oversight. So I gave you quite some examples already of how you can apply blockchain and DLT. The goals are information reliability, safeguarding of assets, compliance with applicable laws and regulations, and more efficient and effective interactions between members because of disintermediation. Distributed ledger technology is not new. It's just a combination of all the technologies that are combined in a very smart way. Don't link blockchain directly to cryptocurrencies. It's just cryptocurrencies, it's Bitcoin, for example, it's just one application, which may or may not make it, but all the other applications of blockchain, they may become much bigger than we now expect. Much more bigger than, for example, Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies. Okay, I'm a little few minutes, but one question. I can imagine that people want to leave now. Okay, no questions anymore. And I thank you for your attention. And have a nice evening on this hot summer evening. Now you can go outside, sit on your terrace with a nice glass of wine. That's what I'm going to do, at least. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you, Eddie, for explaining this to us.
Okay, you're welcome. Bye-bye. Thank you.